you. Hi, everyone. Hello. My name is Neha, and I'm here to talk to you about Facilitation Techniques 202. It's a lightning fast class that goes after Facilitation Techniques 101 that you've all taken. So we're going to go through some very specific things that I've learned about over the last 9 years to help you tweak the facilitation techniques that you use today to make them more inclusive, engaging, and productive. So how are we going to do that? We got 4 sections. So we're going to talk about setting the stage, engaging your audience, making sure it's more inclusive, and finishing with a bang. So what is the first thing that it comes about when we're talking about setting the stage? Usually, we're talking about an agenda. So I'm going to show you an example. And by the way, my photos are really terrible because I'm authentic, and I showed you stuff that's actually from my camera. So that's why I really apologize. But I wanted you to see things that I've actually used. So here you can see, this is an agenda that I used a few years ago. And I wanted to point out some specific things that are here. Not only are agendas great for aligning on goals and letting people know that you're actually serious and what's actually going to happen, but it can pack in a lot of information for different audiences. I believe that an agenda is actually an inclusive tool when it's used correctly. So here's one example. Right here, you can see a timeline. So in this timeline, you can see not only when things are starting and beginning, but if you do it right and you actually ask for feedback at the beginning, you can get to know whether people think that we are spending time in the right different places. And for the introverts, like myself, I can know when I want to speak up and what I want to prepare for, especially if I want to share the right information. Now, also embedded within this are breaks. Now, breaks are really important to me as an introvert because I need guaranteed quiet time. I need to know when I'm going to recharge. I also, like any other human, have to use the bathroom occasionally, and I want to know if I need to hold it in now or if I should just go when I need to go, right? So having an agenda and showing when you have your breaks, when your lunchtime is really good. And as a facilitator, I like to use my breaks as a way to take when we have really important points where you need to reflect. I like to put my breaks right after, right? So if you're talking about problems, you're talking about something controversial, it's really nice to put a break right after so that people can regroup after they get some time to think about in the bathroom or talk with some other folks outside. This is also really good for people who are in lots of other meetings or maybe on call. People need to check their notifications. They're going to do it in the meeting or outside, but if you tell them when they can go and check their notifications, you might have a better chance at people paying attention during the content. Now, I have a confession to make. I actually have a lot of trouble. I'm like, okay, so no, I shouldn't talk about my negatives first, right? I should talk about my positives. So I'm really good at paying attention to the nitty-gritty. I'm a very detail-oriented person. What I'm not good about is knowing where we're going. So I might see an agenda, and I might know exactly what we're doing, but I kind of don't have a really good idea of when we're transitioning, right? Are we talking about the next topic? Should I save my questions? When are we going to move on? So checking off the different items on your agenda or crossing them out is a really great way to signify that we're concluding one topic and we're moving on to the other. So I really like using this, and it also really helps because I tend to save all my questions to the end of a section, so I need to know when I can ask those questions. And as a facilitator, it's really good to kind of say, this is the end. So if you have any questions, ask them now, but we're moving on. Sometimes when people are going over time or we're kind of past our time, I just stand next to the agenda with a marker, and it starts moving a little bit more over and over as I cross off the item. So that's also a really great way to transition and notify people that we're about to wrap up. So agendas are an inclusive tool, and I think that this is kind of like my little summary. We're kind of moving on to the next session, and that's how to take your agenda and how to engage your audience. So, and in order to do that, I forgot this other slide. So we want to set the stage. Here's my tip. So when I'm facilitating a session in person, I come in 30 minutes before, and if you're at a place with like really coveted meeting space, that means I have to book that meeting room 30 minutes before to set up the room. So here's an example. I have a team that spans from Sweden to Hawaii, so we're never in the same time zone, and we really need these special times to come together and make the best use out of our time. So this is how I set up this room. You can kind of see an easel, you can see some snacks, you can see some water, you can see power plugs. Power plugs do signify that you can use your laptop, though, so it depends on what message you want to deliver. You have some post-its, you have some pens and pencils. One thing that is hard to see here, but is right in front of your face, is seating. Seating is a great way to ensure that everyone has a seat at the table. And so just counting out the number of seats that you have and making sure that everyone can sit down is like a very tiny gesture that you have to do beforehand. And what I recommend for you as a facilitator is often we're trying to struggle between like being the person with the facilitator hat on and then being the person that joins the conversation. So by providing an extra chair at that table, you can kind of sit down and join the conversation, and you can use that as a way to like signify to other people when you're transitioning between the two hats. And that means when you stand up, people know that something's about to happen. The other thing that I think is really cool is that if you have breakout sessions, right, you can use that as a way for people to move around. One thing that I saw that was really particularly poignant for me was that if we were talking about feelings, I saw one group sit down. And so by everyone sitting down, you're kind of like in a down-to-earth way, physically and metaphorically. And so that's kind of a really nice way to kind of show the transition. So NPR just posted an article about their Go Bag, right, for workshops. And I really love this because they have all of their materials in one go. I used to work at Pivotal, and we actually had buckets to do the same thing. So you can have all of your supplies in one place, Sharpies, stickers for dot voting, markers, Post-its. I kind of want to highlight my favorite material. And so I know y'all are going to laugh at me, but I specifically always order on Amazon the Post-it super sticky portable tabletop easel pad with dry erase panel. So this has everything you could possibly need in one go. And I order every time. I'll show you the cost sheet in a second. This not only allows you to, if you have like separate breakout sessions, you can put them up on the tabletop and people can collaborate together. Then you can tear that sheet off, you can put it up around the room, and it won't fall off. And if it does fall off, then inside your Go Bag is going to be painter's tape, so you can tape things up. So this is one of my favorite things. That is kind of like the two pieces that I want to talk about when it comes to setting the stage. But I did you one more, and I went into my Amazon order about what I actually ordered for the last one, and I have exactly what I ordered. So if you're looking for some other things that you might want to use, here's what I use. And I know it's not super cheap, but for $100, if I'm shipping everyone around the world to one room, I want to have the right tools in front of me at the right time to do the right thing. And so this is $100 for, you know, 10 people coming together in one room. And you can see the dry erase board is on here. Is it? Yeah, it's the second to last item. And there's two of them, so it's like $18, right? It's not that bad. Okay, so now that you've set the stage, you've set your agenda, I want to talk about what's behind the scenes, and that is designing your agenda in a right way to weave through together the right facilitation techniques. So I know this is really scary. As you can tell, I'm a very detail-oriented person. I'm going to break this apart and kind of show you how I've woven different facilitation techniques to make an agenda a lot more appealing and engaging for a person. So you can see here we have four sections. This was for a team who had only met once before, and they were going to meet monthly afterwards. So I had to get people familiar with each other and talking to each other. So we've got some pairing. We've got some individual work and thinking. We've got some voluntary sharing and required sharing. And we have some board work, so people are getting up out of their seats, walking over to a board, and dot voting. And as you can see here, this is like a symphony. So the symphony is that people are kind of engaging with each other, warming up with each other, getting to share that back, thinking, sharing back again, and then we're kind of rinse and repeating. And as you go towards the end, you kind of want to do this all over again because you want people to think about the important problems. You want them to have someone to brainstorm with so they have that shared experience, and then you want them to share and then kind of post back. So this is what I did for a meeting like 1 month ago, I think in the last month. And you know, everyone would make fun of me for it because I'm like so prepared, but at the same time, it's because it has a purpose. So the last thing that I kind of want to talk about is that Pat had said that you don't need to have enough understanding on it. You don't have to be an expert, right? You just have to understand enough to facilitate the right conversations. And I kind of want to talk about this when it comes to facilitating a meeting, right? All you need to know is the right techniques to get the right information out. And that means that ideally, everyone else is spending 90% talking and you're spending around 10%. So that's my goal. I always monitor that. And if I do have people who are particularly interested in sharing and helping me out, I often assign them roles, whether it's timekeeping, taking notes, and taking photos. And sometimes, especially when it's a technical topic that I honestly know nothing about, but I don't want people to know, I ask the most technical person in the room to write up on the board and take notes about our conversation. So all I'm doing is, tell me more. And then the person's actually writing all of the technical jargon on the board. So don't tell anyone that I've ever worked for before. But that's like my little trick that I do. The third section that we want to talk about is personalities. So I think all of us have experienced a time where we had a steamroller in the room, and we've also had quieter folks in the room, right? Paula Kennedy had talked about listening to those quieter folks in the room and how to do that. So I want to walk you through a few techniques that I do to re-level that playing field. The first one is about post-its and a round robin. So this is where you give people a prompt, and everyone is writing one idea per post-it, and then you ask people to take their top five, single them out, take the other five, rip them up, which is like very masochistic, but people find it releasing after the third or fourth time. Or they enjoy other people ripping up their post-it notes, and so that's kind of like a Schadenfreude kind of thing. And then the second part is the round robin. So the round robin is where each person says their top thing, and then if anyone and kind of like raises their hand with the post-it, and then if anyone else has that idea, they also can share, oh yeah, I have another post-it that's similar. You get to group these together, you kind of save the time that people are saying the same thing, and then because everyone is going around in a circle, everyone's spoken once before the same person speaks twice. So I really like this technique, especially when we have someone who's speaking a lot. And the other thing that I really like is a museum walk. So a museum walk is where you separate people into small groups, you give them a prompt, and then since they're using the wonderful super sticky easel tabletop with a dry erase board thing, they tear these off and they put them up around the walls. And so museum walk is really all of you kind of coming together and you're reading all of the content around the room together. And so instead of someone who's presenting and speaking the whole time, you give people time to read, and then all you do is you say, does anyone have any clarifying questions? And so all of a sudden, you have content that is written up on the wall instead of people who are talking all the time. I also like to just say, hey, let's have everyone share one idea each. Or you can have people share their first idea, write it up on a wall, and then you can have people dot vote. And the really important thing about dot voting is that often when you're in person together, it's really hard to speak up against other people and say, like, oh, I want to talk about something that the most senior person does not want to talk about. But when you vote, right, those votes are really hard to attribute to a person, and so you can kind of see what people want to prioritize and go with that. And the last thing I want to talk about is for quieter folks. So it's really important to give them a warning ahead of time of when they're going to share together. And so I really like to use the agenda as a way to say, hey, there's going to be a time where we're all going to share back together. So just a heads up, that's coming up in 10 minutes. And they kind of have that warning. The last thing that I'll do is a fallback, and I really hope to never do this. Sometimes I'll do it for a conference if I'm like facilitating a conference. The rule is to let three people speak before you speak again. Now, honestly, you're not going to get people to do this right away, but it's about building that awareness of how much you're talking and then how much other people are talking. And so over time, hopefully it'll get better. The last thing I'll talk about is in this section is taking a break when things get heated. I keep on forgetting this one, but honestly, when you have people talking together, it's about something that they're passionate about. And so things can get heated. You can always say, hey, let's take 10 minutes, let's come back together, and then you can reframe that conversation. I've seen so many people do this, and as an individual attendee of a meeting, you can always do this too. You can suggest to the facilitator, why don't we take 10 minutes? And I can assure you they'll be appreciative that you've done that. Here's an example of something that I've done. This is a retro over the last 6 months. You can kind of see some painter's tape use and then some post-its demarcating different months. And what we did is we talked about things that went really well and things that didn't go so well. And you can see here people have shared their ideas, they've grouped them together, they've dot voted on them, and then ultimately we used this to talk about what we wanted to keep, change, and watch. And that turned into a list of experiments that we wanted to work on. So you can kind of see some of the evidence right here. The last thing I want to talk about is the last section, finish with a bang. Rebecca Hill had mentioned swag yesterday, so we know that that's a great way to commemorate something that's going on. And for appreciations, I think Joanna just talked about how to show appreciation for each other. So what we do is you take everyone's name on a post-it in an in-person wall, and they get their own column. And if you ask everyone to write appreciations for each other, they get that time to share what they've thought, and everyone else can take their entire column, come away with it, and read it later. So that's what I've shared with you today. Those are their four sections. And I'm going to leave you with one more technique, and it's about thumb voting. So I'm going to have you all vote with me today so you can experiment with me. So thumb is, I learned something new, thumbs up. To the side is, no, but this was a good refresher. And thumbs down is, this was 101 material I totally know. So what do y'all vote? Oh my God, I have so many thumbs up, I'm so excited. The last thing, if we're gonna finish with a bang, we're gonna have an action item, right? So I want you to tweet, you can tweet at me and I'll retweet you. What is one thing that you wanna try next time you wanna facilitate? So thank you so much, this was Facilitation 202.